Praise the Lord. Oh, what a beautiful morning this is. I bring greetings to you from my own church in Alwal, from my family. And it is such a joy to be amongst you this morning time. I can certainly tell you I'm not half as important or special as I am made out to be. It is but the grace of God which enables each one of us to be here this morning time. As Pastor mentioned, it is indeed a very, very special Sunday, a very special day in itself as we celebrate the fifth anniversary and the entering into the sixth year. Although Pastor mentioned it was not something which was just planned and started, but I can definitely tell you in faith that God had a definite day and plan in mind when He started this particular ministry. So first and foremost, I would like to congratulate and I would like to wish not just the pastor, the elders, but each one of you, every single person who's here, a very happy anniversary for your church, our church, for the church of the living God. As I was sitting there and as I was pondering over what I must bring to you this this morning time, first and foremost, what came to my mind was the number six. So that is where we are going in right now, isn't it? So we've completed five and now we are entering into the sixth year. Now when God was creating the world, the universe, what did He create on day six? What did He create on day six? He created you and I, us, humankind, mankind, isn't it? For the first 5 days, He put in place every other thing which was required for the very best of His creation, which was to come on day six. So the 5 years which have gone by, God has done everything, given you everything, put in place in everything for the very best, which is going to come in the year six for you. For this ministry. As I have been part of this for the last year and a little bit, I have myself seen some of the things getting added, some of the new dimensions to your ministry. And I firmly believe, and I will again borrow the words from Blessin as he was saying, now it is time to take off. You're fueled in, your passengers are boarded, your food is in, you're on the runway, you're taking speed. Now it's time to take off. See, day six represents the finest of God's creation, the finest of God's work. He just did not speak it out. He, in fact, did it with His own hands. For 5 days, He was sitting in the heavenly realms and commanding by the power of His voice for things to come into existence. But on day six, He came down, picked up the material that was required, breathed His own life into it, and brought into form you and I, the very best of God's creation, the very best of God's work is to unfold in the year ahead. This is what the Lord wants me to tell each one of you. God is personally going to work in and through you in the sixth year. Thus far, you may have felt that He is doing things, but what is to happen is far greater than what has happened so far. See, of all the creation, of all the universe that is around us, there is nothing which compares to you and I. And it is not my words, it is the word of the Heavenly Father Himself, that He loved you and I so much that He put His own Son at stake to save you and I. No mountain, no valley, no river, no desert, no forest, nothing is so dear to the Lord as you and I are. And this morning He wants to remind you, He wants me to tell you that what is going to unfold in this year ahead is going to be by far unseen, unheard, unthought ever. But also, while I was sitting there, it also reminded me that God through Moses gave the law to the Israelites, telling them that for 6 years they have to till the land, and seventh year is going to be the is going to be the year of rest. So usually we are all corporate employees. So how are we on Fridays? Do we work a lot or do we just look forward to Saturday, Sunday? We look forward to Saturday and Sunday. It's the day off, right? So not a lot of work happens, isn't it? It's difficult. How many of you really feel like, okay, it's Friday, let me go to work and finish all the work I have not finished in the week? Or how many of us think, okay, it's Friday, I'm going to look at it on Monday? It's usually the second option, right? Yes? So I also want to remind you that the sixth year will also be a year of challenges. Because if you look at a piece of land, or if you look at a piece of machinery, if you worked with that land or with that machinery for 5 years, and the seventh year is the holiday year, the sixth year is when the machine is at its lowest capacity. The sixth year, the land is at its lowest productivity. What is this guy saying? Just 2 minutes ago, he was saying something very positive, and now he's saying that it's not going to be so productive. So what I want to remind you also is that this year, you will have to work even harder. Your efforts will have to increase. See, the land is already, it has been used to maximum capacity in 5 years. But if the bounty is going to be great in the sixth year so that it can feed you in the seventh year, then you have to work harder, I have to work harder. There is no doubt that God is going to do great and mighty things, but God is going to do great and mighty things through you. So are you up for it? Are you willing to do it? The year is going to be a great year. Are you going to rise to the occasion? Are you willing to rise to the occasion? Another thing before we actually get into the message this morning time. Now, we all very painfully remember the World Cup, don't we? Just a few months ago. So when Dhoni got run out in the semi-final, all our hopes went down the river. How many of us felt sad? The pastor's hand went up first. Even me, I mean. And let's go back 12 years, 2007, India, Pakistan, in Johannesburg, Misbahul Haq plays that scoop, Srisant is standing, and then he takes the catch. How many of us felt elated? Yeah, there is at least one hand, mine too. I mean, it was like the most amazing day. India wins the World Cup. Okay, let me remind you. Another thing, Dhoni hits that sixth of Kusal Parera, Mumbai, April 2, 2011. I still remember where I was watching the match. Why I am saying this is that when there is a great celebration, I may not be directly involved with it, but I can feel happy about it. Isn't it? So I want to ask you this morning time, are you like that spectator who has nothing to do with that match, who will not make a dime or a rupee out of that, and yet you feel the celebration? Or are you that MS Dhoni who is in that moment doing the thing and actually making something out of it? See, we are celebrating the anniversary, no doubt. But are you a spectator who is celebrating someone else's victory? Or are you that one person who has worked hard, been through it, and are celebrating it? There is a whole lot of difference. I want you to ponder on this. I want you to think about, are you just that spectator? See, it doesn't matter. Should it really matter to me if India wins the World Cup? Did I get anything? Not a rupee came into my bank account. Forget rupee. Dhoni did not even acknowledge me in the post-match presentation that Venus was cheering so hard. Actually, we had a prayer meeting that day followed by dinner. We skipped the dinner and then went back to watch the final few overs. Did he even ever once, he's had how many years, 8 years time. Did he even once in one interview say, have you heard anybody? I have not heard. And yet it, see, I remember the date, the year, the moment I can close my eyes and I know how the bat went. I know how Yuvraj Singh ran to him and hugged him. Everything I remember. So am I like that? On this fifth anniversary, am I just that spectator who from the sidelines has seen the English service for 5 years and is celebrating this anniversary? Then I want you to make the sixth year different. Come be a part of it. Work for it. And the sixth anniversary celebration is going to be different for you. And that's true celebration. Can anybody comprehend the kind of joy that MS Dhoni would have felt? Or forget about MS Dhoni. Have you seen pictures of Gary Kirsten putting his arms aloft? He is, for God's sake, a South African. And yet he worked for that victory. And I can damn sure tell you, more than any other Indian, he would have felt happy. Why? He was in it. He was working for it. He had put his blood, sweat and tears for that victory. And that emotion cannot be compared to anyone else's. Am I right? The sixth year, come and be a part of the work. Get into the mix. Do the hard yards. And the sixth anniversary is going to be different for you. Today you may feel great. Oh, English service is celebrating 5 years. You may feel amazing. But I can tell you, if you are a part of the work for the entire year, the sixth year is going to be a whole damn different year. And that is what my message is for you this morning time. Both for this church and for your personal life, what our focus should be for year six. Although the year is six, I just have three things to tell you this morning time. And they may be very, very simple things. They are not the most profound things you may have heard in life. But this morning time, the Lord wants me to tell you to change your focus. To refocus on a few things. Shall we turn our attention to Philippians chapter 3? Philippians chapter 3 verses 11 onwards. Sorry, 12 onwards. And it says, not that I have already attained or that I'm already perfect, but I press on that I may hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the reading of your scriptures this morning time, O Lord, as you are about to speak to us, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. May your spirit work amongst us, O Lord Jesus. May it take control of our ears and our hearts this morning time, O Lord, and teach us what exactly you want to talk to us, Lord. May these words, O Lord, do not go waste, O Lord, because what your word goes out to accomplish, O Lord, it does. In your name we ask. Amen. So this morning time, as we look at this particular scripture portion, Paul is writing to the church in Philippi, and he's telling them a few things. From this, we will glean three simple things what Paul is trying to tell us where our focus should be. So the focus for the year ahead for Bethel and for Venus. So you say your own name when you say that sentence, for Bethel and for Blessen, for Bethel and for Percy, and so on and so forth. So what it says first and foremost, it says in verse 13, it says, I count not myself to have apprehended. In another translation, it says, I do not count as if I have done something. That is, I have finished something. That is, as if I am already completed my race. So first and foremost, as we celebrate an anniversary, I want you to focus on the bigger things. The fifth anniversary is a very, very small thing in the larger scheme the Lord has in plan for you. You know, sometimes what happens is we get so caught up in these celebrations, in these numbers, in these milestones, in these events, that we lose focus of the bigger reality that God has for us. I'll give you an example. You know, all of us have seen New Year celebrations. Now, I do not know if it's a blessing or a curse, but for the first 30 years of my life, every single New Year, I was in the church for my watch night service. But last 2 years, because of my work commitments, I have been out of the city and not in the church. And I have now very closely seen how the world celebrates New Year, although I had heard about it, but having seen it personally gives you a new perspective. Now let me ask you, what is the definition of a year scientifically? You know, today there is, at least in the last few days, there is a lot of newfound astronomy experts in our country. So let me ask you, what is the definition of a year? All of you have studied physics. See, if you look at the definition of a year, it is the time which the earth takes to go around the sun and come back to the same point. That is defined as a year. So roughly it is 365 days and a few hours, and we discount the few hours, and every 4 years we add a leap year. We all know that, right? So what is happening is, like, say for example, if the earth is here on September 8th, 2018, and if this is the sun, what it, the year is essentially the earth went around and then came back to the same place. That is what is the completion of a year. Am I right? Yes? So, have we moved forward or have we stayed at the same place? See, the earth was here on 2018, September 8th. The earth went around the sun and then came back here. So I want to ask you, have we moved forward or have we stayed at the same place? We move forward, yes. And how many of you say move forward? How many of you say stayed the same place? Okay. Very optimistic people. I like that. Anybody who says we've stayed the same place? Okay, let me be the cynic. Let me be the pessimist. And say, in more or less many ways, we've actually stayed at the same place. Because if you look at this particular year which went by, and the year which is in front of us, 90% of the things will stay the same. You will have the same fever, you will walk on the same road, you will eat the same food, you will wear the same clothes, you will have the same emotion, you will cry for the same things, you will miss the same people, you will be with the same people. 90% of things will stay the same. 10% variation here or there. You may lose somebody, you may add somebody, you may visit a new place, you may have a new experience, but that is going to be a very small percentage of it. Now, how many of you agree with my cynical view? Yeah, realistically speaking, isn't it? And yet every single New Year I see people celebrate in a manner as though, now there is no tomorrow, that is how I'm going to celebrate today. So what I want to get to is the fact that, you know, these milestones, these celebrations, these years are very, very small in the greater context of what the Lord has in store for us. And this morning time, I want you to focus on the bigger things. In Telugu, there is a saying, I'm going to translate it. And it says, essentially what it says is, the day of pride for a father is not when a son is born, but it is the day when he actually becomes something important in life. So today was the day the English service was born 5 years ago. Although it is a matter of great joy for the father, the real day of pride is something when you become something for him. So do not lose focus of that. We should be happy. I'm not one of those people who says don't celebrate birthdays. You know, there are some people who say birthday is nothing but a day that when you are a year closer to your death. Not saying anything like that. What I'm trying to say is that there is a larger context There is a larger picture. There is a larger story. There is a bigger narrative that you and I should not lose focus of. So what it means is that, like Paul says, now Paul is a guy who's writing this to a church, and Paul was somebody who had seen it all in his life. He had seen the greatest of glory, and he's seen the depths of despair. He is probably the greatest missionary, the greatest Christian leader ever to have lived on the face of this planet. And this guy says, I don't think I have done anything. Which means he says, I am still work in progress. So just because we complete a set of years, we cannot just feel great now. Oh, 5 years we've done it, man. There are so many churches who are so far behind us. Yes, I have arrived. This morning time, I want to remind you that there is a greater reality. If a man like Paul can say, I am yet to arrive, I want you to remind yourself this morning time, we are yet to arrive. I'm not trying to dampen your spirits. I'm trying to give you a dose of reality. That there is a far greater thing for you to accomplish than just 5 years. Do not be satisfied. Do not be happy. Do not be overjoyed that you have completed 5. Look at the fact that there is a far, far greater work that is ahead of you. If Paul, now some theologians say that Paul actually did not write this epistle at one go. They say that this was written in 3 parts, in 3 different times. And this particular portion which we are looking at was written in the final stages. So Paul, when in his final stages, can say, I am not yet a completed product. You and I are far, far away from it. Now yesterday everybody were looking at the pictures of the moon mission. How much did it miss by? Now this 2.1 is part of national history. Isn't it? Everybody is talking about it. And how many are talking about the 370 kilometers that it actually took? I want to remind you, when you look at the big picture, the small things will make a big difference. It's the small things. How much did Dhoni get run out by? 1 centimeter. Yes? That 1 centimeter was the difference between victory and defeat. The 2.1 kilometers. I have very poor math skills, but you can calculate. 2 kilometers, how much percentage of it is 378 kilometers? It must be less than 0.00000 something. And yet, is that mission a failure or a success? Now, like all Indians, we won the hearts, but we lost the match kind of scenario. Now, everybody is proud of ISRO, but in the record books, it is a failed mission. Yes or no? This morning time, I want you to focus on the big picture. And on the other side, see, God is also telling you that it is the small things that will make you great. How much of faith does God want from us? How much of faith does He expect from us? As small, as little as a mustard seed. If you can miss the great by little, you can attain the great by just that little. There are great things ahead of us. But God just wants you to have that little faith. Because when you look at the bigger picture, it's the small little things which will make a great deal of difference. What we have done so far will have some meaning if what we are going to do is meaningful. So far we must have done great. So far we must have done excellent. So far we must have done everything according to what we must. But if in the days ahead, we do not stick by those same principles, then what we have done thus far is pointless. I do not have to remind you of the example of Mrs. Lot. For all the distance that she traveled, one moment of turning back was the end of her story. Today, how do we remember her? Tomorrow, how will people remember you? Depends on what you're going to do ahead. Do you just want to be remembered as another ministry which started, flourished, but did not accomplish? Because there are such ministries by the dozen in this very city. Or do you want to look at the big picture, stay steadfast, all hands on deck, and continue to push forward as Paul is pushing forward? This morning time, let us realign our focus on the bigger things. 5 years is too small in the great eternity that the Lord has planned for us. Secondly, Paul will come back to verse 13 again. It says, but one thing that I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are before. This morning time, focus on what is ahead. A lot of times we tend to live off our past glory. I know so many people, like a lot of people are now accusing MS Dhoni of holding on to his place based on all his past performances, isn't it? Yeah? This morning time, I want to remind you, focus on what is ahead. What is gone, whether it was good or bad, it is all done. Nothing can be undone. It's good that we take a moment to celebrate. It's good that we take a moment to remember. It is good that we take a few moments to learn. But now is the time to look forward. Most of the times we are so enchanted by our own past, of the great things that we quote unquote have done, that we celebrate so much of our past history that our future is so ruined. This morning time, I want you to realign your focus to what is ahead. Because what is ahead is far, far greater than what has gone by. In the book of Isaiah, the Lord says, do not dwell on the former things. Look ahead that I'm doing great things. Isn't that, that's what the book of Isaiah says, right? Isaiah 43:18. Do not dwell on the past. A God is not a God of the past. A God is a God of the future. And the future is ahead of us. See, Paul, at the end of his life, it's almost over. Like I said, he's done it all. He was the greatest guy living on the planet at that point of time. And that guy says, it is not the past which concerns me. It is the future that I'm worried about. Future which was greater than his own lifetime. I know almost every one of us here is very young, so there is a far greater life ahead of us. But when I say that you have to look to the future, it is not just in our lifetimes, but it is beyond our lifetimes. Focus on what is ahead. Ecclesiastes 7:10, it says, do not worry about the former days. And who is saying this? The greatest, the wisest man ever to have lived on the planet. He says, don't worry about the past. Look at the future. And this was a guy who had seen riches and women and opulence and glory and everything. This was the guy who built the greatest temple for the Lord. And this guy says, don't worry about the past. Worry about the future. This morning time, I want to remind you, put your focus on things which are ahead of you. Look at the Israelites. They came out of Egypt. They were out of bondage. They were walking through the desert. God was leading them every single day, every single morning. They would see the cloud on top of their head every single night. The fire would keep watch over them, keep them warm every day. There was food magically appearing on the ground. And yet, what do they say in the book of Numbers? Oh, we had pots of meat and fish back in Egypt. And we are more or less like that. We often look back and we worry about, or we think about, we reminisce about, we eulogize about the past. This morning time, the Lord is reminding us, look to the future. There is a great future God has enshrined for every single one of us, personally, individually, collectively, as a ministry. Look ahead to that. And like I said, like Paul is also saying in another translation, he says, I am straining forward, which means it is not going to be easy to go forward. It takes effort. Just because I want to go forward, everything is not going to be a bed of roses. Even if Paul wants to go forward, he says, I am straining forward. I am trying hard. I am finding it difficult, and yet I keep on going forward. Things may be challenging, and I do not have to recount how things are becoming challenging in India. But as one great man said, when the going gets tough, the tough have got to get going. So what are you made of? Are you made of snowflakes? Or are you really made of the sterner stuff? This year is going to challenge your faith, my dear friends. While the great things are to happen, and the great things are to happen through you, but if you do not have real faith, if you are not as tough as nails, you might fall by the wayside. Are you willing to strain hard as Paul? Are you willing to work hard? Are you willing to put those extra hours? Are you willing to go the extra mile? Are you willing to put the extra effort? Because going forward is going to be hard work. There is something called as a headwind. Have you heard of a headwind? When you move forward, the resistance that you see in the opposite direction. There are great headwinds that we are seeing, not just this in this country, but in our own city. Not just from those who are against us, but there are headwinds from those who are for us. But amongst all these things, put your focus on what is ahead. Finally, verse 14, Paul says, I press towards the goal, the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Focus on the actual prize. The actual prize is never earthly. The actual prize is never what you receive here. The actual prize is never something which man can ever give you. The actual prize is the heavenly one which Christ Jesus alone can give you. 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 30 years, 100 years, 120, or even a millennium. Whatever you may complete, I want to remind you that your prize is not in this world. Your actual prize is in the heavens. This morning time, focus on that heavenly prize. Colossians 3:2, Paul says, set your heart not on things of the earth, but those in the heavenly places. This morning time, when you look ahead to the year 6, I do not want you to worry about what are we going to have, how many people, what is it that going to be here in earth, but worry about how many people you are adding to the kingdom of the heaven. Because your reward is not an earthly reward, your reward is the heavenly reward. It's not how this place is going to change. It's not about what furniture comes in. It's not about the riches that are going to be added to our bank balance. That is not the great thing which the Lord is expecting to do in the year ahead. What the Lord is expecting to do is to add more people to His kingdom through you. And worry about that. Now there's a video recording going on. So next year, don't put this video up and say, okay, it's the same walls, it's the same paint, it's the same screen, so nothing great has happened. Focus on the actual heavenly reward. And same thing goes for your personal lives. You might think I'm in the same job, I'm drawing the same salary, I'm living in the same house, I have the same set of challenges. But this morning time, I want to remind you that for all those things which are same in your life, there is a greater heavenly reward which is awaiting you all. What are you worried about this morning time? Is it what concerns the earth, or is it what concerns the heavens? See, even Peter, he was trying to tell something to Jesus in the book of Matthew 16th chapter. And Jesus condemns Peter and he says, "Get thee behind me, Satan, because your thoughts are about what is happening on this world, and mine are about what is to do with the heavens." This morning time, put your focus on the heavenly reward, on the actual reward. The year ahead of us, I believe, I trust, I fully am aware of the fact that it's going to be a great year for this church, for its members, for its ministry. But for that to come through, for that to come true, we have to put our focus right this morning time. We have to see the bigger picture. Don't worry about all the other small details which go around and which are not important. Focus on the big picture. Don't worry about all that has happened, all the great things or the not so great things. And say, this is what we did, this is what we could have done, this is good, this is not good, and so on and so forth. Just look forward, because that is where the Lord wants you to concentrate. Do not dwell on the things of the past. And finally, focus on the heavenly reward. Don't worry about what different physically is going to be in this place in a year's time. Focus on what heavenly reward you can reap when you walk on the footstep the Lord has planned for you. As all of us, as we close our eyes and ponder into our own lives and wonder where our focus is this morning time, are we like the spectator sitting off far in a corner, celebrating a victory that is not his or her own? Or are we that individual who is right in the mix of things, participating, working hard, achieving something and celebrating? If this morning time you are somebody who is in the far-flung areas, I want you to come inside. I want you to get into the mix. I want you to put your hands on the deck. I want you to take the reins into your hands and start participating. Celebrating from far away is of no value, is meaningless. Get in here and you will see the difference. As a church, as a ministry, as individuals, I urge you this morning time to look at the big picture. Don't worry about the small details. Don't worry about all the paraphernalia which goes around these numbers, these events, and these milestones and so on. Look at the big picture. There is a greater calling to each one of you individually. Don't worry about what has gone by. If you have done great, glory to God. If you have done not so great, then my dear friend, my dear brother, my dear sister, I urge you that there are greater things to come and you can be a part of it. Look ahead. Finally, in our lives, what we get here on earth is so insignificant, is so immaterial. Our reward is from the heavens, because our labor is for the heavens. It is no man that we work for. It is no man that we seek to please. All glory and honor is for the Lord, and He will reward us in the most just and honorable manner. I do not know who is sitting here this morning time as every eye remains closed. I invite you to be part of this celebration. These 5 years will be worth it if thus far you have not accepted the Lord. But this morning time He is working in your heart to put your focus on Him. Because you have always been His focus. All these 5 years you have been His focus, and yet you have chosen to stay far away. This morning time the Lord is speaking directly to your heart, asking you to come inside and be a part of the celebration. Like the father of the prodigal son, the Lord is waiting at the gate for you to return, my friend. You know who you are. The Lord is speaking to you this morning time so clearly, urging you to come be a part of the celebration. I don't know for whom the Lord has put this word in my heart, but there is someone out there who's on the fringes, who's far away, who's a spectator, who's a bystander. That bystander will have to become a family member this morning time. The member of the family of the Heavenly Father. I do not know if there is another opportunity. Do not let this one go by. Take it. There is a celebration in this house this morning time. Make that celebration bigger by coming inside, by taking part in it, by becoming a participant, by becoming a member, by becoming one in the family of the Lord. If there is anyone out there, please accept this call from the Father. He's waiting for you. You've been focusing on all the other things so far. But this morning, it is time to focus on Him. Put your sights on Him. Give your life to Him. There are great and mighty things to unfold in this place. In this very sanctuary, through you, somebody who may be on the outside today will be the key player in the days to come. God is calling out to you this morning time. Even as we pray and close, whoever it might be, you do not have to stand, you do not have to do anything. In your heart, wherever you may be sitting, heed to that call this morning time. The Lord has an open invitation. No questions asked, no conditions laid. He wants you to come inside. He wants you to get into the mix. He wants you to be a participant. He wants you to be a son. He wants you to be a daughter. He wants you to be a member of this family. Take the invite. He'll hold your hand and He'll take you further. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for this beautiful morning time, O Lord. As 5 years are behind us, O Lord, the sixth one is in front of us. We thank You for Your goodness. We thank You for Your grace, Your love, and Your mercies, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, what joy, O Lord, that You've given us this new year, O Lord. And You have told us this morning time that great things are ahead of us, O Master. Hallelujah, Lord. And may our hearts, O Lord, be focused on those great things, O Lord, Master. Hallelujah, Lord. On those things which are ahead of us, O Lord. And the heavenly reward that You have set forth before us, O Lord. Let us not dwell upon our past, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Because You say that you do not worry about our past at all, O God Jesus. Hallelujah, Master. Help us, O Lord, to go forward with Your mission, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. O Lord Jesus, may this ministry, may this church, O Lord, be an example, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. In this area, in this city, in this country, O Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank You for the great things that You have planned. We thank You for the great things that will happen, O Lord. Because we trust that Your word, O Lord, hallelujah, does not, will not ever return empty-handed, O Lord. We thank You for those hearts which have come into Your presence this morning time, O Lord Jesus. Oh Lord, we know that You are working in those hearts, O Lord Master. Hallelujah, Lord. Continue to stir them, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Father. As they become a part of this family, O Lord, Help us, O Lord, to embrace them. And because of them, the celebration becomes so greater, O Lord. We thank you, we praise you, Lord. We thank you for our dear pastor, his family, O Lord. We thank you for my brothers and sisters in this place, O Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, O Lord. We thank you for the love and fellowship that you've given us, O Lord. We once again thank you for the years gone by, but we thank you more for the years that are ahead of us. We thank you, we praise you. We ask this small plea in the name of our mighty and matchless Savior, Jesus Christ. And everyone said, Amen.